Hello and welcome to The Rules of Investing, brought to you by Livewire Markets. I'm your host, David Thornton. Few of us would have predicted that by June this year, the S&P 500 would not only be positive, but up over 11%. On face value, a healthy market. But dig a little deeper and it quickly becomes apparent that this performance has been carried by the big mega-cap tech stocks. Such is their performance and the lack of performance by the rest of the market, that Apple, Microsoft, Alphabet, and Nvidia now account for a third of the index. This all begs the question, what next? Do these mega-cap tech stocks sell off? Does the rest of the market trade up? Will it be a bit of both? These questions and more are answered by today's guest, Jacob Mitchell, founder, CIO, and lead portfolio manager at Antipodes Partners. Antipodes houses two global funds, an emerging markets fund, and an actively traded global shares ETF, ticker code AGX1. Before starting Antipodes, Jacob spent 14 years at Platinum Asset Management, where, as co-CIO and lead portfolio manager of the flagship Platinum International Fund, he oversaw $3.5 billion in assets under management. In the episode, Jacob goes to town on a lot of topics, including his bear case for consumer-facing mega-cap tech, whether the AI boom is in fact a bubble, where he's seeing low multiples despite strong earnings growth, and the stocks that will lead the way through the next cycle. If you're an Apple Podcast or Spotify user, don't forget to subscribe to the podcast so you don't miss an episode. Or if you're a Livewire subscriber already, hit the follow button at the bottom of the wire to get notified whenever we post new content. Not a Livewire subscriber yet? Head over to livewiremarkets.com. It's free to sign up and you'll get access to the leading investment minds from Australia and abroad. Jacob Mitchell, thank you for joining us on The Rules of Investing.
David, it's great to be here.
When you look at today's market, there's just been this enormous flight to size, this concentration. You know, Apple, Microsoft, Amazon, Alphabet, and Nvidia now make up about a quarter of the S&P 500. Where to from here? What does normalization look like? Or is this a new normal?
Yeah, it's interesting. It feels like almost an echo bubble of the duration trade, which got very crowded as central banks effectively, probably pushed down rates, and you had negative real yields and had this massive growth bubble, and then it peaked in let's call it 2020, probably 2021. And then started to unwind through last year. And a lot of the more, the weaker businesses, the businesses we describe as sort of growth traps, started to be found out to be more cyclical. And then it morphed into, let's call it, the core of the growth quality complex, the mega cap tech stocks. And then we've had a bounce. It'll be interesting. Look, we feel like it's more that it's probably a reflection of just how risk-averse investors have become, that they're crowding into what they perceive to be very defensive companies, and these companies do have great moats. They do have pricing power. However, I also feel like parts of that complex are maturing and, they're not what they were. And so I think what's next could be just more dispersion around the mega cap tech stocks, a winnowing out between those that are still structural growers and those that are mature, more cyclical, and probably should trade on ultimately lower multiples, the growth traps.
Yeah, it's ironic that these same companies that investors were flocking to for growth, they're now flocking to the many of the same companies for safety.
I understand that. I mean, in our own portfolios, we, over the past 18 months, we've sort of progressively positioned in, let's call it, more defensive expressions of pragmatic value stocks, stocks that are not only cheap relative to their growth profile, but also have relatively, let's call it, less economically sensitive businesses. Some of the consumer staples, some of the healthcare complex, some of these software names, Oracle, SAP. So we have, you know, we've done that, and it's been arguably the right thing to do. So I understand why investors are looking for defense as opposed to offense. It's just a question of whether some of these mega caps will actually prove to be, you know, defensive.
I've got to ask you, everywhere you look now, you see AI, ChatGPT mentioned. Is it a bubble in your mind?
As George Soros once said, if it is, you know, what's the first thing to do? Buy it, which is what I think investors are sort of doing. Like in that sort of, that same sort of continuing that thought around, well, is this sort of an echo bubble of that big duration bubble, growth bubble that we had, and now it's expressed in a different way, AI. Look, it's really too early to know what this price action means. I mean, based on our experience investing, usually the first iteration of a new business model or new technology, there's a lot of excitement, like we saw with, say, Internet 1.0. And then a lot of boredom, and often the companies that were seen as the early winners actually aren't. You know, as the technology is adopted, investors get bored by how long it takes, and then eventually you get these dominant companies who have mastered the technology, like Google or Facebook or Microsoft, and then, you know, you get a major adoption cycle and a lot of value is created. So it feels like we're in that 1.0 step where there's a wide range of outcomes, a lot of excitement. You know, you might make some money quickly, but it may take then, you may go through a real sorting out period to work out who actually has a monetization model, who the real winners are. And so, look, you've got to go through that. And clearly we're looking for those, you know, those companies that are the longer term structural winners from AI.
Is there some regulatory risk here? I mean, we saw a little while ago what happened to Facebook's share price when Zuckerberg was hauled in front of Congress. And now there's increasing congressional oversight with AI. Do you view that element as part of the washing out process for this thematic?
Yeah, sure, especially as it relates to consumer data. I think it's arguably less of an issue as it relates to, say, what Oracle or SAP or Microsoft could do inside their existing, you know, productivity apps or ERP apps, you know, where they're simply, you know, deploying a new, predictive management tools within the existing software. Look, I don't think... Yeah, that's fairly straightforward. Look, when it comes to use cases that start to impinge on our daily lives, members of the public, you know, that's when it gets a little bit murkier, and obviously Congress and all regulators are very focused on how private data is used, and Meta and Alphabet have, you know, clearly, you know, had to respond to that. And you know, sometimes these regulations have the opposite intended effect, right? Because it's only the large companies who actually have the capability of, you know, number one, they influence the regulation. Number two, they have the capability of navigating it. And so it builds another barrier to entry. So I'm not sure it's necessarily a super negative thing, but, it's certainly an issue that the companies are going to have to deal with.
Let's keep it high level. On the one hand, we still have restrictive monetary policy from the Fed and the RBA, ongoing stress in the banking system, slowing growth. But on the other hand, we have China's reopening. How do you see all of this washing out in terms of market valuations?
Yeah, there's definitely some fairly stark choices as an investor. Even accounting for sector composition, the US really does still stand out as a fairly expensive market on roughly 19 times P forward earnings. And earnings are expected to be flat this year, which is we find sort of somewhat surprising. And then you've got the rest of the world, which is on about 13 times. And even, as I said, you know, adjusting for sector differences, it's roughly the same, you know, across different sectors. Probably slightly less, but still there's a big gap even on a sector neutral basis. So yeah, look, and arguably a lot, not only are earnings expectations lower, i.e. off their peaks in both China and Europe, due to arguably, you know, the conditions or the economy as it was last year. You know, you had the energy crisis impacting European earnings expectations, and you've had this big slowdown, consumer slowdown in China, not just because of, let's call it, lockdowns, but also because of policy around the property sector. And you know, corporates have been dealing with regulatory changes in China, so confidence was certainly impacted. And look, we think that's normalizing for China. So not only do you have low earnings, but you also have, I think, a more supportive policy environment in China. And what's probably most important is just flexibility on policy. So they're not dealing with inflation in China, and so they can loosen a lot more if they so desire. And we think that type of stimulus will come in the form of consumer end market, so demand side stimulus, rather than the traditional supply side stimulus of sort of infrastructure spending. The market in the short term, though, is responding to Chinese data that's not coming as strong as expected, especially in the manufacturing sector, which has been impacted by weak external demand, you know, as consumer spending really slows down in the West. And then secondly, that property sector in China, which is going to take a few years to reach some form of equilibrium.
So do you see a disconnect between PEs and market valuations and company fundamentals and earnings, or are they marrying up?
So yes, we do. In fact, there are great opportunities, I think. You know, there is a lot of what we call multiple dispersion, which just means, you know, the difference between the ratio of, let's call it, the low multiple stocks over the high multiple stocks. That ratio hasn't really moved much off its lows, even though you had this big rebound in what investors called the value factor. A lot of the companies that are in that low multiple bucket also had relatively good earnings growth. You know, financials responded to higher rates. You know, NIM margins until recently were expanding, still expanding in most parts of the world, except the US. And then energy had obviously responded to a combination of higher prices, and also just the fact that their balance sheets are healing as CapEx is fundamentally low. So we don't think you've reset that multiple dispersion that much. So there's still great opportunities. And that dispersion is not just across the whole market. It's also, we often find it within each sector, within regions. It's fairly pervasive. So that's great. I think that means it's a good environment for just bottom-up stock picking. All active managers say that. And obviously in the last 3 months, the concentrated nature of the market calls that into question, because it's sort of eight stocks that are working. But as I said, I think that's a little echo response rather than a fundamental change in sort of the regime shift that we've seen coming for a while, which is, you know, there's a different regime, one where we think the fiscal policy lever is being used a lot more, and it's probably going to lead to just a higher amplitude in the economic cycle, especially in the West. And central banks have been sort of amplifying those fiscal moves rather than acting in a countercyclical manner. And that you know, it's preparing for a more volatile economic cycle, and one where maybe it's not the only story in town is, you know, let's call it digital advertising and cloud adoption, But, you know, the big one being onshoring and the energy transition. I mean, the energy transition comes with a very high price tag, and it's already got policy support in most of the key regions. It's labor intensive, it's capital intensive, it doesn't solve for productivity, it solves for climate risk. And it favors a whole lot of new winners, a lot of industrial companies, some of the utilities, and that's the structural change that we think is not efficiently priced at the moment. And you're at the early stages of that versus, say, digital advertising, which is arguably fairly mature.
So do you see those smaller companies gapping up? Do you see those mega caps selling off, and, you know, or do you see the two meeting in the middle? And what is the catalyst for those things happening? It seems like it's the Fed pause that markets are waiting for with bated breath.
Yeah, the Fed pause. I mean, the Fed's like, you know, threading the needle, and, you know, they may, you know, you've got to be open to the idea that they may pull off a soft landing where they can actually not only pause, but they can actually pivot. And arguably, you know, given the pressure that is on, say, consumer discretionary in the US, or, you know, you're already seeing a real decline now in retail sales, or you see on the financials in the US, you kind of need a pivot. You know, you need to start cutting rates to take some pressure off those businesses. And those banks are, you know, clearly they're not going to keep lending and supporting the economy if they're worried about their capital position, if they're worried about their net interest margins. And so that's, I think, a precondition, if you like, for, say, that domestic, US domestically or Western domestically exposed part of the market, you know, discretionary financials, you know, parts of housing. Then you have the, as you said, mega cap. So what needs to go right for that to keep working? Or I think, as I said earlier, dispersion is coming, right? They're not all at the same point of their adoption cycles. And, you know, that I think it's just going to be results, right? Like, most analysts are extrapolating an acceleration in top line for Alphabet, for Meta, for Tesla. And we just don't see it. We don't see it. Like, the stocks have worked because of better margin. You know, margins have come off pretty low expectations, and, you know, that's better OPEX control, and that's not a surprise given how arguably bloated some of these companies became. But we don't see the case for top line acceleration in consumer facing mega cap tech in 12 months' time. We don't see, even if you get a pause and, quite frankly, a pivot, the pivot will be either the soft landing version, but I don't think it means the economy's off to the races, or it's the hard landing version where, wow, the economy's, you know, unemployment's rising and the Fed's getting not so much worried about inflation, they're worried about maintaining employment. So we would be more constructive on the cloud-facing companies or the companies that are adopting AI in existing software platforms like Oracle, SAP, Microsoft. We don't see the maturity, as it's not mature. Mm-hmm. You know, cloud adoption's arguably 25-30% done. It's a little bit boring. You know, it's not growing as it was in the early days. And in the case of Amazon, it's AWS, it's slowed a lot. But it's going to stay... It's going to grow, and we think it's going to grow faster than, let's call it, nominal GDP, which is, you know, I can't really say that for consumer-facing mega-cap tech. So more dispersion there. I think that will just get sorted out by results, the sorts of results we see in 12 months' time. And then, you know, the new structural winners, I think the market will just want to start to see, okay, how is this the policy-led cycle that we're all speaking about or discussing or we all know is coming? Is it, you know, how are companies individually executing to take advantage of that? And, you know, we think companies like Siemens Energy, the margin of error around that is quite narrow because they, you know, they arguably service lots of different steps on that of that energy transition. and it's really core to their business, as opposed to some sort of concept.
Yeah, so if the market does get its mojo back, whatever that looks like and whenever that is, which parts of the market do you see? You touched on, you know, the energy transition there. Which parts of the market will you be most interested in?
Well, in outside of the Western markets, I think you just need to be patient around the China and the Chinese, Chinese economy and the recovery that we're expecting. It's not, we don't, for Chinese consumer-facing equities, whether they're internet companies or consumer goods companies or you know, let's call it exposed appliance makers like Midea, the sorts of multiples they're on, they're kind of like the lowest types of multiples. Many of these companies are on record low multiples, especially in an absolute sense, but also in a relative sense, right? So they don't need to grow that fast for, I think, investors to make money. You could say some of the geopolitical concerns, maybe you just need a small reduction, like you're pricing in a very high, you know, equity risk premium in China or China facing equities. So just sort of delivering on relatively low expectations, and a small reduction in, let's call it that, a very high risk premium, you'll actually make good returns out of those companies. But it may take a bit of patience. And we see that right across that whole, there's the reopening beneficiaries, there's companies that are just really strong multinational companies emerging in China. You know, reopening beneficiary would be something like the Macau facing stocks, Galaxy. In the multinational bucket, I put a company like Midea, makes 25% of the world's air conditioners. It's really got a really strong scale position. And it's the sort of thing that appliance demand is the sort of thing the Chinese governments will stimulate. You know, energy efficiency upgrade, you know, targeting lower income demographics. I think it's a perfect for that. And then in the middle, you've got some of the internet platforms, which, you know, they're priced for growth purgatory, right? They're priced as if they're never going to grow. They're going to keep shrinking. And I think you can be selective there. And there'll be some, you've got a company like Alibaba, Baidu. Baidu's sort of one of those companies that a lot of investors sort of forgot about, but it's actually relatively well positioned, we think, for cloud adoption in China, and also the deployment of some of these large language models in the core of their business.
So how are you positioning the portfolio right now? What moves are you making ahead of those things you just mentioned?
Yeah, so keeping, like, we're holding the line on those China exposures. In Europe, the majority of what we own is actually, you would characterize it as feeding into a number of different sort of global themes rather than being a macro play on Europe. And whether that's Siemens and Siemens Energy in for that, you know, supply chain re-engineering that comes with the energy transition, or Sanofi, which is a pharmaceutical company, which we think is 12 times PE, just seems mispriced relative to its earnings power and its the diversification it has by business. So, and not significant amount of patent risk in its pharmaceutical business. It has the vaccine business as well, and a consumer health business, which should trade on quite a high multiple. It's like a consumer staple business. Shouldn't be on 12 times. That part of their business could be priced on, you know, PE of 20. So, yeah, we think about Europe more as it's a great hunting ground for mispriced multinationals, and it's been a great place for us to find opportunities. And then if you go to the US, we're on the margin starting to think about, well, what's priced for a recession now in the US? We don't think the mega caps, most of the mega caps are really pricing in a recession. So we are underweight there, but you know, you are starting to see areas in the market amongst the banks looking for a bank exposure. We've been looking at those banks that can navigate this squeeze on ROE that's coming from, you know, high deposit costs and an inability to pass that on to, you know, to their borrowers, that which is the fundamental problem, right? You know, deposits in, it's amazing that, you know, the average American depositor is getting like 1.5% and they can park their cash at a money market fund and get over 5%. So now why is that? It's because rates went up so fast, right? And that's, we've got to be all a little bit cautious here because it's all about transmission and, you know, the market's getting very comfortable because it hasn't really seen much economic weakness, that there is not going to be any. We think that's a little bit, you know, that's sort of probably not the right way to think about it. It's thinking about, well, as it happens, how's it going to impact and what's priced? So if we can find a bank like, you know, Capital One Financial is a great example of a bank that can manage, because its primary lending is to on credit cards, and it's a variable rate product. So they can reprice, you know, they can reprice the asset side, as and they're already paying arguably a fair price on their deposits. So we think that company is better positioned than a lot of the other, you know, regional banks. And, you know, if in fact we do have this soft landing scenario, then it's very cheap because the credit costs, you know, the market's assumptions around credit costs will be too pessimistic. Mm-hmm. So I think that's a good example of how we're thinking about the US. Also, you know, you've had the US pass the Inflation Reduction Act. You've had the US pass the CHIPS Act. Yeah, they are getting serious about spending money and they still haven't repaired the fiscal position. So got to keep that in mind, right? Investors are very happy to think that the US can borrow and spend without any cost. We'll see. I mean, the recent rebound in mega cap tech could actually also just be an outworking of like looser liquidity conditions in the US, which are about to tighten again, right? So,
well, I wanted to touch on that. You mentioned before the flight of capital to these money market funds, and you know, money supply M2, as it's called, is falling off a cliff. Yeah. Given that liquidity situation and the slim equity risk premium we have at the moment, are equities worth it? Buying them right now?
Yeah, look, it's on 20 to 19 times, you think, scratch your head and think, are they worth it? Absolutely. And even if you take a company like Apple, I mean, yeah, great company, not growing. Is it really worth 30 times? What's, you know, handset, you know, the Apple ecosystem looks pretty mature to me. It's a good one. It's hard to break, but it also looks like
it's very mature.
Mature, right? So, yeah, I think I would argue you're not being compensated much there unless you think it's, you know, unless you really think real yields are going to go back to negative, you know, bond yields are going back to the two, you know, under two, and real yields are going to negative, and you just want a equity that's going to behave like a bond, then I think there's nothing, you know, you're not pricing in risk. So where, you know, on that, so you've got the Fed's doing QT and roughly, let's call it $80 billion a month that's ongoing, and you also have now, because the debt ceiling has once again has been averted because, let's face it, Republicans and Democrats both want to spend.
Oh, Groundhog Day.
Yeah. But neither of them are fiscal conservatives, right? They're both parties of fiscal activists. And, you know, that means the Treasury will now start rebuilding. It ran down all of its cash. Now, as it runs down cash, it's really stimulatory to both the economy and to financial markets, because you're literally creating deposits in the banking system. You're creating reserve. You're creating deposit, creating reserves. When the reverse happens, i.e., they, instead of spending money, you start issuing bonds, the opposite starts to happen, right? So the US government's going to start, you know, that turnaround in the next 3 months is probably going to be about $600 billion of combination of QT and the Treasury issuing bonds. Fed selling bonds, the Treasury selling bonds. That money comes out of the economy, comes out of the financial markets, and it can arguably, you know, can impact asset prices. So we would be saying, you know, the range of outcomes is quite wide. You know, be constructive on individual stocks, but also, you know, think about what the tails look like and whether there's, you know, relatively cheap protection from some of the negative tail events.
You recently stated that infrastructure exposed companies will take over mega cap tech as the secular winners of tomorrow. Now everyone loves that kind of story.
Yeah.
Can you walk us through the thesis?
Yeah, look, it's an oversimplification in the sense that, as I mentioned, you know, we do think there's ongoing opportunity in mega cap tech. It's just that we're sort of separating them into, let's call it, consumer facing and non-consumer facing. But you know, where's the new what's going to be the real excitement, which investors aren't really thinking about? Where will you get the real step change? Look, AI is a step change, absolutely. So we get that, and you know, it's thinking about what that means in a long term sense. But also, I think, you know, energy transition is a step change. I mean, you're talking about taking spending, even in a modern economy where you already have some transition happening. And you've got the wealth to pay for it. We think at least a 2% per annum step up, permanent step up in investment that needs to stay in place for a couple of decades, and that is to essentially remove fossils completely from transport, from heating, from our existing power generation. And what does it all mean? Well, at least a doubling of our power capacity, and putting and resizing the grid and reorienting the grid. So doubling generation, doubling the investment in the grid, rough numbers. The current rate, you know, like that's, these are numbers which it's hard to actually, you know, actually try and think about, bring it back to a tangible, what does it mean? But, you know, if you think about wind generation, which is actually the closest thing we have to base load power from renewables, offshore wind. So not onshore, but offshore, where it's pretty persistent. That's where a lot of the European deployments are going to go, and around the world, if you have that option, it's going to be used because it's less. People are less sensitive to NIMBYism. There's three major wind companies in the world: Siemens Energy, which owns Siemens Gamesa, and then you've got Vestas and GE. Now, the Chinese players are there, but they don't tend to operate. If they operate outside of China, it's generally only in emerging markets. They don't get typically access to DMs. Even that supply chain alone, you're probably looking at a 7x step up in annual output, you know, for a very long period of time in order to deliver the outcome that, that the transition to net zero needs. I mean, I don't know. I mean, stocks price for that, and the implications for that down supply chains, like the amount of your copper, aluminium, green metals, lithium. Now, there's not everything is. We're not saying everything's an opportunity. Make that clear. You can have an amazing capex cycle, and you know, a lack of any. There's very few companies where you think, well, actually, that's not a great. There's no real quality. Yeah, what's the resilient business here that I can actually invest in for over a multi-decade period? And so it's matching the two. You know, finding great businesses that are mispriced and relative to, say, a big change in demand. And that's what we see in our energy transition cluster.
Yeah, the energy transition, net zero, decarb, whatever you want to call it, it's a funny one because you're seeing so much interest and investment on the government side. You're seeing an enormous amount of interest and investment from the institutional investors. But then, I mean, you know, working at Livewire, anecdotally, I'm seeing a lot of skepticism on the retail side. A lot of investors just aren't buying in to the technology, the need for the technology, the fact it's such a nascent technology. They're very skeptical of that. So how do you see retail money interacting with this thematic as we move forward?
Yeah, look, that's great. I mean, it's a great observation. We would be sympathetic to that view. I mean, retail investors did not have a great experience with many of the, let's call it, green energy ETFs, right? Because it was a, you know, they came out of that same growth chasing mentality, and stocks that weren't great businesses that were perceived to be, you know, high growth opportunities, you know, ended up on high multiples of revenue or orders or whatever. And then, you know, they're struggling because the multiples never made sense, and they weren't actually probably core in many ways. Some of them weren't even providing a sustainable solution. So yeah, we're sympathetic to the view, the skepticism. So what, you know, how are we thinking about this? Look, the reality is this, because it is a trend that touches so many parts of the economy and the market, you know, there are lots of different ways to gain exposure in, you know, across the spectrum of both growth and risk. You know, for example, in the US, and this is where we're very constructive on the US, many of the regulated utilities are already deploying renewables pretty aggressively, and they were doing it before the Inflation Reduction Act actually increased the subsidies, because they were doing it in the Midwest for wind, or in the, you know, or in the South for solar, and it was actually just competitive power. And the great thing about that US utility space is they haven't really gone through the big deregulation. You can get many integrated utilities where you get the generator, you get the transmission, the distribution, all in one package. And it's a regulated asset base. And as an equity investor, fantastic. You know, you that company can deploy capital, gets a guaranteed return on that capital. And what you're playing for here is a higher growth opportunity. Those companies are going to grow faster because we're replacing effectively petrol with electricity as the US goes through a big EV cycle, as it will. And so you just got a very low risk way of gaining exposure. So we own a company, American Electric Power, because that it's exactly doing, gives us a high weight to the transition to renewable generation, and it has a large transmission footprint. So very safe way, like, you know, PE of 15 times, attractive dividend yield. And we just see it similar to what happened with data centers when cloud took off. You know, they were boring REITs, and then they became exciting growth REITs. Still very boring businesses, they just started growing faster. So I think in electrical utilities, you do have a great opportunity to play this energy transition in something really safe. By the way, energy transition doesn't mean oil, hydrocarbons are dead. You know, we own Total Energies in the portfolio. And it's actually, in some ways, our research in this area highlighted that even the conventional energy companies were underinvesting. So not only, you know, you can make a bear case over multiple decades for oil demand around energy transition. Yes, you can. But these companies were already underinvesting because they'd gone through a down cycle in the oil price, and they were already under pressure from shareholders around ESG issues. And so, you know, it's actually from a pragmatic value perspective, we have exposure to oil. We're not screening out oil companies. We have a preference for those who are proactively addressing, you know, risk in their portfolio. And Total Energies is doing that. You know, they have one of the highest weights to natural gas and renewables and hydrogen. But natural gas is their big play. And, you know, that is a credible transition fuel. I mean, half of the emissions for electrical generation, if you say coal versus natural gas, you're getting roughly half of the emissions output. So we can't do this cold turkey, otherwise you won't have an economy to decarbonize. And we think some of those conventional energy companies, assuming they're on that journey, are part of that solution. And then, you know, you can, if I've touched on the capital provider, the utilities, you can have the equipment providers like Siemens Energy. And then, as I mentioned, that change in the profile for materials such as copper and aluminium. We're not as constructive right now on the materials versus, say, the capital providers and the equipment providers, because you still get a lot of China sensitivity in the materials companies. And I don't think the market's yet worked out that change in growth composition in China away from property and infrastructure towards the consumer means structurally lower, you know, commodity demand.
Yeah, well, I mean, what's the investment case for those legacy fossil fuel companies? You explained in depth there the fact that, you know, we need them to facilitate this transition. But, you know, a lot of people buy stocks with a view to holding them for the long term.
Yeah.
And I guess the outlook for that depends in turn on the pace of the transition.
Yeah.
So for someone who say is skeptical of a purely, you know, pure play transition investment,
yeah,
and they do want to, you know, acknowledging that fossil fuels aren't going anywhere anytime soon, they do want to invest in those legacy companies.
Yeah.
What is the growth outlook for those companies, the investment case today looking forward?
Yeah, look, you know, oil is not a, you know, used to, it's sort of a, you know, let's call it GDP growth business. I mean, you can extrapolate an environment where oil demand just isn't growing and then starts to fall, right? So you would want to set, I sort of understand some investors will say, well, on that basis, I'm just not interested. I think you can sort of say, well, what is my payback period, you know, and what's being implied into the multiple today in terms of how many years do I need before I get my capital back? And then is there any terminal value here? And I think some of the companies will have, you know, they will have terminal value because they're already investing in, let's call it the renewables, or, you know, they're investing in transition assets. So they're redeploying capital already.
So just on that, do you see a company like Shell Oil literally at some point shifting its entire business model from fossil to renewables?
Look, we don't own Shell because we feel like it's a company. Well, we, based on our assessment anyway, Total Energies has been more forward-looking, less reactive, a better long-term allocator of capital. And that's what's important in this transition, right? It's easy to build renewables. It's hard to build them and make an acceptable level of return. And that's what we think we're getting in Total, is a company that's focused ultimately on returns. Capital allocation is what matters the most in this transition. And knowing when not to, you know, go for incremental capex in the old energy complex, and to know when it makes sense to do it in the new, because not everything, you know, will make sense all the time. So capital discipline is very important, and in navigating that and avoiding, you know, the stranded asset sort of value trap.
We've talked a lot today about risk in markets, so what are you doing at the moment to hedge that risk? Is there much alpha to be had from your shorts currently?
It's still an environment, I think, where there is, you know, there is good opportunities on the short side, because you haven't, I think, you're still, in this, there's still a lot of hope, I would argue, that it's all going to be okay. And it's look, you know, going through, we leverage our industry research to find longs and shorts. You know, we're looking just in the shorts, actually just the longer term losers, especially if they're, you know, priced on aggressive multiples. And, you know, we see a catalyst where, you know, that the vulnerability of the business will be, you know, if it's a company that's been priced as if it's going to grow forever, there's a catalyst in play which will prove that it's actually more mature than the market thinks and more, let's call it, cyclical than the market thinks. Or if it's a, you know, if it's a cyclical company but it's, and it's on a really punchy multiple, you know, where the market's extrapolating the cycle just to last forever. Both, you know, we have shorts in the book exposed to both sides of that. Yeah, look, I think lots of very high multiple dispersion means I think there's still a reasonable amount of dispersion in the market to give you good shorting opportunities at single stock shorts and on tail risk hedging. The tail risk, which, you know, where, you know, obviously most investors are exposed to, is that if the market's being held up, it's essentially by eight stocks, and the liquidity environment was, you know, you already had a lot of monetary tightening, and, you know, the economy, whilst the economy is not falling apart, there is, yeah, there are signs of stress. It is, you know, whether you are actually just, you haven't priced in the recession. I think, you know, our portfolios are somewhat positioned already for that because we are underweight the US, let's call it the US consumer. So it's not so much that we're not prepared for that scenario. It's sort of thinking through, well, how. And it's a tricky, right? It's a tricky environment because the macro, the recession is the most anticipated recession probably on record. So it's not, we don't think we have much of an edge there. So it's probably just sort of thinking, well, how much are we prepared? We've got our single stock shorts, and that's probably in this environment, leaning on your longs, your idiosyncratic long opportunity, leaning on your idiosyncratic short opportunity, I think is what, you know, helps you navigate, a fairly tricky environment where there is a lot of consensus thinking from the top down about, you know, this recession that's coming. And you know, we should be thinking about the flip side as well. Well, what if it doesn't, you know, that soft landing scenario, how does that impact our portfolio, and which levers will we pull if that becomes more of the base case?
Okay, so I'm sure you won't speak to your current short positions, but how about this? Can you give us the sectors those shorts belong to? And then on the flip side, you mentioned those idiosyncratic longs. So, yeah, if you could speak to a couple of those, would be great.
Well, all of our longs are idiosyncratic. but I'll give you
maybe the highest conviction ones.
Yeah. Look, on shorts, I mean, something, you know, that really I think typifies how we think about using industry research, right, to find the longer term winners, longer term losers, and then think about how they're priced, and, you know, and what their profile looks like from a catalyst perspective. In the telco space in the US, it's really interesting. You know, the US has had one of the most profitable telco markets in terms of the size of the profit pool, how much money gets made per average subscriber. And it's had fairly light touch regulation. And now a couple of things are changing. T-Mobile, which we owned long, has a really great spectrum position and has started, you know, has really used that transition to, you know, to 5G to take share, push, you know, take profitable share in the market, and it had the merger with Sprint. So we've that's fantastic. We've benefited from that. Now, what we're seeing, because we follow, you know, we're following this pretty closely, is, you know, the response to that's coming, the competitive response. And we're also seeing sort of fairly, some pretty heavy discounting coming from, really being triggered by what the cable companies. So the cable companies are under a fair amount of pressure in the US as well, right? Because it's old-fashioned cable, you know, the old-fashioned hybrid coaxial. And they've been pushing that technology to the limit, right, with, you know, streaming, everyone's requirements in COVID. And just quite frankly, fiber to the home is a better solution. And so you've got overbuilders in the US who are rolling out. And where these, wherever the overbuilder who takes fiber against cable typically ends up with roughly half of the market. Gets sort of, and so that got priced, that's been priced into the cable companies, because one day they're going to either have to become fiber companies or their businesses will just slowly shrink. So what are they doing? They're starting to bundle really low cost mobile plans in with their cable offering. And the US, the three US telcos who arguably have been more of an oligopoly up until this point, have decided to facilitate that. So they're giving these really low, you know, they're facilitating this sort of race to the bottom in terms of subscriber offering. And so the competitive dynamics are shifting in a fairly negative sense. And, you know, we've been, that's one of our sort of, you know, we've been, yeah, that's been an opportunity for us.
All right, Jacob, we always finish these interviews with three favourite questions we pose to our fundies. Question one, what's one thing investors are getting wrong about markets today?
I think it's the, you know, it is this this sort of expectation that, you know, nothing's changed, we're back to the old regime, and there's no, I think, fundamental appreciation that, yeah, we are in the West for a bunch of different reasons. We're unlikely to go back to that secular stagnation environment of low growth, low real yields, and with the only game in town being you know, growth at any price. It just does not seem to sit with what we see from what governments are doing. And secondly, we think investors probably have been so, you know, there's so much chasing of passive that they're, you know, your benchmark is arguably reflecting a lot of yesterday's winners. And just even if you take a regional, even if you're, you know, I can understand investors would be skeptical because I'm an active manager, I would say that. But just take, you know, the, let's call it those simple PEs, you know, 64% of the market is, you know, let's call it US, it's on roughly 19 times. You've got this, the rest of the world, you know, the rest of the world from a GDP perspective, the, you know, the US is, let's call it 20% of world GDP, 64% of world market cap, or not market cap, but ACWI. You've got this big wide world out there that is the residual, and that's trading on 13 times. So maybe that, yeah, we should be open to having more of an allocation outside the US. And it's not to shun the US and say there's nothing interesting there. As I've said in this podcast, there's lots of interesting things happening there. I think the third aspect is investors need to be conscious, I think, of just how much macro dispersion there is. We've never seen it like this before. You know, how even amongst the Western economies, the difference in, say, the smaller open economies like the UK and Australia, where inflation is being pretty sticky. Central banks are tightening more than they would relative to, let's call it, systemic risk in terms of household level of household debt, say versus the US, where, wow, let's have another rate rise, you know, nothing to see here, just a few issues in the banking sector. So the shock has been taking in the banking sector in the US rather than in the household, And then you flip it around. And look, we also see it in, say, Scandinavia, where you have real issues in the property sector. And the central banks are grappling with inflation. So now you go to the China, and China's like, it's sort of on this different cycle. It's, you know, even if it's not recovering super fast, they have, you know, they're thinking about stimulus, and they're thinking about, you know, how do we protect the economy? And then they're behaving in a really counter-cyclical manner, both relative to COVID, you know, they didn't overstimulate. And also relative to what the West does. And I think in some ways they may have wanted to see the resolution of the debt crisis in the US, just to see that they had clear runway to maybe start to look for different types of stimulus in order, you know, if they're really concerned about how the economy is growing and whether they need to offset slowdown in the West. So, yeah, amazing levels of, let's call it, stock level dispersion across sectors, across regions, and also just macro level dispersion. So I think it's a really interesting environment, you know, for a combination of top down and bottom up working together. Yeah.
Jacob, I asked for one, you gave me three. That's brilliant. All right, question two. Could you share a story of a big win or a big loss in your career, or both? What happened and what did you learn from it?
Let's talk about the positive first. The win, you know, I've owned Microsoft, or, you know, owned it in portfolios for quite a long while now, you know, prior to Antipodes and great, really resilient businesses, which we say in our parlance is, you know, multiple ways of winning, like, combined with, you know, a fairly narrow set of outcomes, like where your margin of error is pretty low, don't come along that often. And, you know, early last decade, kind of Microsoft, that's what Microsoft, there was a lot of uncertainty, and, you know, that's the market, I think, was becoming a bit irrational around. It was Microsoft was trading on a PE of 12. It was seen as a loser to a lot of what was going on. But you were, you know, you could see those early signs of change, i.e. they had launched Azure, you know, Office 365 was starting to emerge. You could see that they were thinking about the cloud and what the cloud meant for Microsoft. And, you know, under Ballmer, maybe they didn't communicate those things particularly well. And so a change in leadership definitely probably catalyze more recognition from the market. But it was one of those businesses that was going to be very hard to break. And then, you know, all of a sudden, you know, not only are they slowly positioning, but they start to really accelerate their, you know, their adoption of the cloud and, you know, repositioning the business, and they make some smart acquisitions and they really change. Yeah, so I think that's been a pragmatic value story, and some investors think that value managers, you know, can't hold these stocks for long. Like, you're now, you know, in a cyclical stock, we don't want to hold them for very long. But in a structural story where the market may take a long time to efficiently price it, we're happy to hold them. It's getting harder to hold Microsoft because I think now the AI premium. Yeah, I think it's probably the last. We're probably in the last, let's call it, leg of the journey, and then losers, like, unfortunately, yes. When you think as investors, you know, it's all, sometimes we put a lot of focus on when we invest and buy stocks. We don't put enough focus on sell decisions. And at Antipodes, we've spent, you know, quite a bit of time thinking about how we make sure stocks that are aging the portfolio age well and weed out the ones that are not aging well before they become problems. I think it's more about, I think as a process, you know, being willing to sort of acknowledge any case drift relatively, you know, relatively early and deal with it. And that's the, you know, that's why investors are sometimes, you know, it's sometimes tough to do that, right? Because you've got a lot of sunk cost
fallacy.
Yeah. And so, look, an example. I think we were probably early in. We took exposure in North American natural gas, and it was too early. And part of the problem was that we underestimated just the amount of how much wet gas production would come out of the oil Permian, the real growth in the Permian, and we're just slow to readjust. Now, we did sell, and we also kept monitoring that industry, and we went back in, and we went back in well. So, it was we got it wrong the first time, but we didn't. From a process perspective, I think we responded well as a team. Yeah.
Question three, and this is a pure hypothetical. If markets were to close tomorrow for 5 years and you could only own stock in one company, what company would that be and why?
Yeah, it's a tough question for a couple of reasons because it's the range of outcomes on the next 5 years is really wide. I do think a company, I'm going to lean more towards what, you know, a company, Siemens Energy, which we think is one of tomorrow's winners rather than, you know, staying away from the yesterday winner bucket. And I don't want to go too defensive. Like, Sanofi will be around in 5 years' time, but it's also going to, it's probably only going to be growing at 8-9% per annum. So I think in the case of Siemens Energy, because it has exposure at these different stages of the transition, you know, it has the gas turbine business, and those gas turbines are going to grow. I mean, there's a need for standby power. EM is still in, it's going to be a source of demand. And over time, they will transition even the gas turbines to being hydrogen-fed, so they can be effectively green energy at a point in time. They have this wind turbine business that is just at the beginning of a very long period of structural growth. And it's been challenged because, like, a lot of, you know, the COVID cost or COVID inflation came through, and this is a complex business. The supply chain tends to be relatively complex. Logistics, it's a manufacturing and installation business. But they, based on our quantification, they're getting through that. So margins should start to, what is a loss-making business will transition, we think, to a reasonable margin business. Not high margin, but let's call it 5-8% type margin, but with amazing demand outlook. And then finally, you've got this high voltage transmission business, which is also, you know, going to go through a pretty long duration capex cycle. And all of that, so you can think about it as a one-stop shop for the energy transition. And based on our forward-looking numbers, it's, you know, we think it's a, you know, it's a sort of 4-5, you know, it's a 5x EV to EBIT type multiple, and a really strong management team. And if I, hopefully I don't get myself into trouble, but we featured on our Antipodes recent podcast, we featured an interview with the CEO of that company, interview done by our investment director, Alison Sava. So anyone who wants to hear more, the Good Value podcast.
There you go. Well, Jacob, what a chat that's been. Thank you so much for coming on The Rules of Investing. I'd love to have you back on soon.
Excellent. Thanks, David. It's been a pleasure.
I hope you enjoyed that episode of The Rules of Investing. If you did, be sure to give it a like. If you're not a subscriber yet, you can sign up for free at livewiremarkets.com. I'll see you next time.